about. It leads into the idea of the evil of the church. That's original sin, and I'm going to destroy it. Death is going to die. Is that why they put you here? Yes, they are terrified, and with good reason. He stood up, and so did his demon, proud and beautiful and deadly. Lyra sat still. She was afraid of her father, and she admired him profoundly, and she thought he was stark mad. But who was she to judge? Go to bed, he said. Thorold will show you where to sleep. Good night, child. She woke to find a stranger shaking her arm. And then, as Pantaleon sprang awake and growled, she recognized Thorold. He was holding a naphtha lamp, and his hand was trembling. Miss, get up quickly! I don't know what to do. He's left no orders. I think he's mad, miss. What's happening? Lord Asriel, miss, he's been almost in a delirium since you went to bed. I've never seen him so wild. He packed a lot of instruments and batteries in his sledge, and he harnessed up the dogs and left. But he's got the boy, miss. Roger? He's taken Roger? He told me to wake him and dress him, and I didn't think to argue. I never have. And the boy kept asking for you, miss, but Lord Asriel wanted him alone. You know, when you first came to the door, miss, and he saw you, and he couldn't believe his eyes, and he wanted you gone? Lyra's head was in such a whirl of weariness and fear she could hardly think. Yes, it was because he needed a child to finish his experiment, miss. And Lord Asriel has a way special to himself of bringing about what he wants. He just has to call for something, and now Lyra's head was full of a roar, as if she was trying to stifle some knowledge from her own consciousness. She had got out of bed, and she was reaching for her clothes, and then she suddenly collapsed, and a fierce cry of despair enveloped her. She was uttering it, but it was bigger than she was. It felt as if the despair was uttering her, for she remembered her father's words. The energy that links body and demon is immensely powerful, and to bridge the gap between worlds needed a phenomenal burst of energy. She had just realized what she had done. She had struggled all this way to bring something to Lord Asriel, thinking she knew what he wanted. But what he wanted was a child. She had brought him Roger. That was why she cried out, "I did not send for you!" When he saw her, he had sent for a child, and the fates had brought him his own daughter. Or so he thought, until she'd stepped aside and shown him Roger. Oh, the bitter anguish. She thought she was saving Roger. She shook and sobbed in a frenzy of emotion. It couldn't be true. "Eorg!" she cried, pushing the servant aside. "Where's Eorg Bjornsson, the bear? Is he still outside?" "Help me," she said, trembling all over with weakness and fear. "Help me dress. I gotta go now. Do it quick." He put the lamp down and did as she told him, because when she commanded in that imperious way, she was very like her father. While Pantaleon paced the floor, lashing his tail, his fur almost sparking, she made for the door and felt the cold strike her throat like a sword and freeze the tears on her cheeks. "Eorg Bjornsson, come, because I need you." There was a shake of snow, a clank of metal, and the bear was there. He had been sleeping calmly under the falling snow. Lyra wanted to embrace him. "Well," he said, "we got to catch Lord Asriel. He's taken Roger and he's going to, but I didn't think, oh, Eorg, I beg you, go quick, my dear." "Come then," he said, and she leapt on his back. The tracks of Lord Asriel's sledge ran straight toward a range of jagged hills. And there was a feathered touch of movement on the flank of the highest peak. Pantaleon flew as high as he could and looked with an owl's clear vision. "Yes," he said on her wrist a moment later, "it's Lord Asriel, and he's lashing his dogs on furiously, and there's a child in back." Lyra felt Eorg Bjornsson change pace. Something had caught his attention. "What is it?" Lyra said. He was listening intently, and then she heard a mysterious, vastly distant rustling and crackling, the sound she had heard before, the sound of the aurora. Out of nowhere, a veil of radiance had fallen to hang shimmering in the northern sky. Billions and trillions of charged particles, and possibly dust. going to be a display more brilliant and extraordinary than any Lyra had ever seen, as if the Aurora knew what was about to happen. Lyra turned to Eeyore Berenson. "I gotta go across," she said. "Thank you. I don't know what's gonna happen when I get to him. We might all die." She laid a hand on his head. He nodded gently. "Goodbye, Lyra Silvertongue." Her heart thumping painfully with love, she turned away and set her foot on the bridge. The snow creaked under her, and Pantaleon flew up over the bridge to settle on the snow on the far side and encourage her onwards. Halfway across, a piece fell off near her feet and tumbled into the abyss. The bridge held, but there was no way back. She stood and raised her hand to the watching bear, who stood on his hind legs to acknowledge her, and then turned and raced down the mountain to help his subjects in the battle with Mrs. Coulter and the soldiers from the Zeppelin, and Lyra was alone. Once Eeyore Berenson was out of sight, Lyra felt weak and turned blindly to Pantaleon. "Oh, Pant, I can't go on. I'm frightened and I'm so tired. And all this way and I'm scared to death." Her demon nuzzled at her neck in his cat form. She clung to him blindly, rocking back and forth and letting the sobs cry out wildly over the bare snow. "And even if Mrs. Coulter got to Roger first, there'd be no saving him. And they'd kill me out of vengeance. Why do they do these things to children, Anne, that they want to tear them apart like this?" Pantaleon had no answer. All he could do was hug her close. Little by little, as the storm of fear subsided, cold and frightened, she came to herself again. The moon had set, the sky to the south was profoundly dark. Billions of stars lay on it like diamonds on velvet. They were outshone, though, by the aurora 100 times. Never had Lyra seen it so brilliant and dramatic. And behind the ever-changing cause of light, that other world was clear and solid, and they climbed. And the higher they climbed, the more the bleak land spread out below them. To the north lay the frozen sea, endless, reaching beyond the pole itself. To the east and west, more mountains, great jagged peaks piled high with snow and raked by wind into blade-like edges. To the south lay the way they had come, and Lyra looked longingly back for her dear friend, Eeyore Berenson, and his troops. But nothing stirred on the wide plain. Pantaleon flew high and swooped back to her wrist in his owl form. "They're just beyond the peak. Lord Asriel's laid out all his instruments, and Roger can't move away." As he said that, the aurora flickered and dimmed, and then it went out altogether. In the gloom, Lyra sensed the presence of dust. The air seemed to be full of dark intentions, like the forms of thoughts not yet born. In the dark, she heard a child's cry. "Lyra, Lyra, I'm coming," she cried back and stumbled upwards, struggling at the end of her strength through the ghostly, gleaming snow. "Lyra, Lyra, I'm nearly there, Roger." Pantaleon was changing rapidly in his agitation. Lion, ermine, eagle, wildcat, hare, salamander, owl, leopard, every form he'd ever taken, a kaleidoscope of forms among the dust. "Lyra!" Then she reached the summit and saw, 50 yards away in the starlight, Lord Asriel was twisting together two wires that led to his upturned sledge. He was dressed in heavy furs, his face illuminated by the flame of a naphtha lamp. Crouching like a sphinx beside him was his demon, her beautiful coat glossy with power, her tail moving lazily in the snow. In her mouth, she held Roger's demon. The little creature was struggling, flapping, fighting, one moment a bird, the next a dog, then a cat, a rat, a bird again, and calling every moment to Roger, a few yards off, straining against the heart-deep tug, and crying out with the pain and the cold. He was calling his demon's name and calling Lyra. He ran to Lord Asriel, pleading, begging, sobbing. Lord Asriel took no notice except to knock him to the ground. They were on the edge of a cliff, 1,000 feet above a frozen sea. Beyond was nothing but a huge dark. All this Lyra saw by starlight. But then, as Lord Asriel connected his wires, the aurora blazed into brilliant life, like a long finger of blinding power that plays between two terminals. 1,000 miles high and 10,000 miles long, soaring, undulating, glowing, he was controlling it, leading power down from it, for there was a wire running off a huge reel on the sledge that ran directly upwards to the sky, and the aurora was blazing again. He was nearly ready. He turned to Roger and beckoned. Roger came, shaking his head, begging, crying, helplessly going forward. "No, run!" Lyra cried and hurled herself down the slope at him. Pantaleon leapt at the snow leopard and snatched Roger's demon from her jaws. The snow leopard leapt after him and Pantaleon let Roger's demon go, and both young demons, changing, flick, 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 turned and battled the great spotted beast. She lashed with finger needle-filled claws, roared down even Lyra's cries. Both children were fighting her in the turbid air. They were fighting her form, those dark intentions that came thick and crowding down the streams of dust. The aurora swayed above, surging, flicker picking out now this building, now that lake, that row of palm trees so close, you'd think you could step from this world to that one. But Lyra leapt up and seized Roger's hand, pulled hard, tore him away from Lord Asriel, and they ran hand in hand. Roger cried and twisted,